Hello, my name is Sam Feltham and welcome to Expert Interviews here on Smash the Fat. With me today, all the way from Edinburgh in Scotland, is obesity scientist and nutritionist Emily Maguire. How are you doing, Emily?
Hi, Sam. I'm good. How are you doing?
Very good. Very good. It's a pleasure to have you here. Now, you have a blog and website called lowcarbgenesis.com that people can check out. But before we get into kind of the meat of the story today, why exactly did you kind of go into obesity science and nutrition and weight management and things like that? What was kind of your motivation to get into it?
Yeah, I actually found it through probably a really unconventional way. I know a lot of people found it because they had their own personal journey, you know, a weight loss journey, etc. I am back way back when I was 16, a long time ago, I actually did sports therapy at college and did that until I was 18, worked with that for about a year, and I actually ended up getting a really bad injury in my wrist. Turned out I displaced some bones from working in that. So at 19, I had my doctor tell me that I had to have a career change, basically. And I'd always been really interested in the sport and that kind of aspect of it. And we touched a little bit on nutrition when I did sports therapy. So I kind of thought, you know, actually that could be quite a good way to go down. So it kind of actually happened in a way that, you know, as I say, most people probably wouldn't have gone that way. Got into my first year, and then actually in my second year was kind of where I started finding alternative nutrition approaches, shall we call it? Yeah. And that's kind of where I started getting a lot gripped with it, actually. And at that time as well, I started doing experiment on myself. I was never, you know, extremely overweight or obese myself. I think I did definitely have a bit of weight to lose, so I did go on a little bit of a journey with myself. I mean, I was addicted to crisps and sweets, like there was, you know, going out of fashion. And from there, I really started getting pulled into sort of the obesity side of it, but particularly the really hard science side of it as well. Mm-hmm. A lot of the degree that I did, it came from was like a public health background. And whilst I really like public health nutrition, for me, it just felt too broad and too, you know, we see a lot of the public health messages, and it just wasn't really what I wanted to specialize in. Mm-hmm. And in 2008, I was at a conference at the National Obesity Forum conference, and the Robert Gordon University was there. So Professor Ian Broom was there, and he was literally talking about a brand new MSc course that he was starting up in the year following. And right from there, I saw 2 years to go before the end of my undergrad, but I just knew that it was all about the science. It was, you know, about the physiological mechanisms that are going on. It was about the etiology. It was about what we're doing as a country. And it just really had me gripped because, you know, we could see the problems that we're having. And then, as I said, like, I started getting a lot more into the alternative sides of nutrition and how I was in this kind of weird place. I was being taught a lot of, you know, eat less, do more, it's all about the fat, etc. Whilst at the other side, I was starting to do a lot more work with some companies with low carbohydrate and started to look more into the evidence, and from there it just totally got me gripped. And the good thing, the reason why I particularly went for the obesity science of RGU is because Professor Broom is well known for kind of looking outside the box, and their center is actually, I don't know if you know the systematic or the meta-analysis that came out from the center up there. So it's the major, it's a paper by Hessian et al, and I think it was 2009 got published. So it compares, obviously, meta-analysis comparing low carb to low fat diets, basically, and showed that low carb performed a lot of different aspects with the cardiovascular and weight loss. So the center was really about looking outside the box. What other approaches can we take to, you know, obviously look at obesity, etc. So it wasn't just focusing on this sort of calories in, calories out. So for me, that was kind of why I sort of went down that route. And also from there, I am We'll probably come on to it. I'm probably jumping the gun a little bit with it, Sam. But just before I graduated, I actually had the pleasure of going to the Nutrition Metabolism Conference in 2011. So again, from there, it just totally gripped me on absolutely everything. And the rest, they say, is history, I suppose. And that's how I am here.
absolutely, that's perfect. And as you were kind of sort of alluding to in your background story there, you were kind of being taught about calories in, calories out, and sort of a low-fat message kind of on your bachelor's degree. Was that when that was kind of being taught? And then in your master's degree, it's kind of, you know, causality of this problem is actually kind of flipped. So why is there such confusion with this problem, and kind of what is the root cause of this?
Yeah, I mean, if I hadn't have found, I mean, and this might sound a little bit strange, but I can understand where a lot of dietitians and nutritionists are coming from, because if I hadn't have found the route that I found when I was doing my undergrad, I mean, I thought in your first year, you know, you're taught all about replace everything to low fat, you know, it's all about skim milk and getting as many starch carbohydrates in there as you possibly can. And you genuinely think that what you're being taught is correct, because you've got to remember at the end of the day, you're standing or you've gone to university and these people teaching you are, you know, they're professors, they're lecturers in this field. So why wouldn't you believe them? You know, and I think the problem comes from in my case, I was a little bit older, so I was 19 when I went to university. But in this country, you know, a lot of people go when they're 17. How much do you actually know at the age of 17? And the thing with science, particularly nutrition, is it's all about critical thinking. It's all about asking that person. It's not about arguing, but it's about, you know, that person should be able to stand there and critique what they're saying and justify what they're saying. And I think when we go to university, we develop in that skill as much as learning. And it's not until you get out of university, or maybe in your fourth year, you start getting a little bit more brave and put your hand up and you question that lecturer. But at the end of the day, that lecturer is the person who has got all the knowledge and the information. And I think back and look back to some of the classes that I sat in, and when they came out with certain things, nobody batted an eyelid. Nobody questioned. Some of the stories and some of the things that we were taught was just, looking back, you think, I cannot believe I sat there and did not ask, why is that? You did. You took it as it is. And I think, it's hard to say where's the problem. And because, don't get me wrong, obviously a lot of the lecturers, and particularly lecturers that I was taught under, are very, very clever and intelligent people. I just think we've come from, this is a 30, 40 year, you know, teaching. And even the lecturers that are lecturers nowadays have been taught by another generation that believed the low-fat message, etc. So really, I think it's going to be about small changes that are going to happen. They're already happening, you know, people like Tim Noakes, etc., coming out and saying, actually, do you know what? We got it wrong. And I think as well what the problem is, I mean, Tim could have been absolutely crucified for doing that. That's like saying 30 years of your career was all wrong, you know, and to do that in science is a lot to hold your hands up and say, well, actually, you know, could it be this way? So I think it's quite a difficult question to answer simply, and I think the conversations that we need to have are conversations that aren't too, you know, sort of argumentative and accusatory and he said, she said, you know, that kind of thing. And I think it's important to have the discussion and the debate, but I think as soon as you open up with it, say you're basically telling those people what they've believed for the past 20, 30 years is wrong, you know. So it's how do we have that conversation in an open way that people feel safe and comfortable having that discussion as well, I suppose. As much as we all want to shout and say, here's the evidence, the problem is, and even when I was in university, you never see that evidence. You have no need to go and look for that evidence because there's not an essay question that's asking you on that. Or, I mean, I remember, for example, when we got taught about ketosis, and it was in our biochemistry in second year, and literally our lecturer stood there and said, don't follow the Atkins diet, it's really bad for you, you'll just have really bad breath, and just don't do it. And that was it. That was all we got taught. We never got taught anything about that. Yeah, and looking back, we all just thought, okay. And I remember as well, it was in when the craze of sort of Atkins was coming back, and one of my friends started it, and I just remember having a complete goer and said, what are you doing? This is so unhealthy. Don't you know what you're doing to yourself? I hadn't looked at any of the evidence. I just thought because I was doing this degree and I was being taught what was right, that then therefore that bestowed onto me the knowledge that was right. So I think it's quite a tricky subject, and I think it'd be a bit of a a touchy subject, and you obviously just got to be a bit careful how we approach it. But I think there's some really good people out there that can have that really quite nice conversation that's not too aggressive, because I think we're never going to get particularly dietitians and nutritionists to listen if we're going to be far too aggressive with it.
Absolutely. At the end of the day. Undoubtedly, if you put people kind of on the back foot or back them into a corner, then they're going to bite. You know, as you say, there needs to be kind of like a in the middle of the room kind of discussion that's open, honest, and also productive as well. And sort of giving each other constructive feedback about the holes in each other's kind of arguments and evidence and stuff like that. Because there is kind of holes in both sides of the arguments, but it seems as though the evidence is kind of building towards quite possibly that eating less and exercising more isn't the answer, and that the reason that people eat more and exercise less is probably because they're growing rather than kind of the other way around. They are growing because they're eating more and exercising less. So let's kind of go into that reverse of causality. So the current conventional wisdom is that the reason that we are becoming obese, more and more obese, is because we eat too much and we don't exercise enough. So what's the real causality that's happening here?
I think what the problem that we have at the minute is we're focusing too much on the quantity rather than the quality of what it is that we're eating. Yeah. So we're just looking at calories in the broader sense of the word. And I think too many people, and particularly, you know, females are probably some of the worst for it. Quite often some of the way that I teach people is I'll give them, you know, two snacks, but don't tell them what each of the snacks are, but just tell them the calorie content. And nine times out of ten, people will often go for the one that's got the lower calorie content because they think that's healthier. Mm-hmm. Whereas in actual fact, it could be a handful of nuts and seeds versus a scoop of ice cream. And actually what is going to actually happen in the body is that scoop of ice cream is going to have a different hormonal impact than what the nuts and seeds are. And it's that quality rather than just the quantity. But so many people are just focused on this magic number of just hit your, you know, 1,500 and 1,200 calories per day. But in actual fact, when you look at it, that's not necessarily the way that it does work. And coming back again to when we were taught in university, and we actually had one of our dietitian lecturers who said to us that she didn't care how a person made up their calorie content. So if she put someone on a 1,200 calorie plan, they could eat bread all day if they wanted to, as long as they hit their calorie content. Now, again, looking back, you know, you think, wow, it's, you know, okay.
Oh, my God.
What? Exactly. Now, if you've got someone, I know, now you can see when I look back and just think, how did I sit through 4 years of that? It got harder and harder towards the end, the more that I was kind of branching out. But yeah, it's just looking at it, and unfortunately it's, you know, in food marketing and advertising, you see, you know, a pack of Rolo cookies, it's only got 99 calories, so it's okay to have that, as long as you hit your target. But in actual fact, the food that you're ingesting, and predominantly, unfortunately, is, and now we can see that coming out in the media, the whole sort of thing with sugar, and I think sugar's really getting its day now, which is obviously a matter in itself and quite a good thing within there, is that a lot of these foods are just filled with sugar, because obviously we remove the fats. Fat is obviously palatable, and therefore you need to replace it with something. Can't be salt, because there have obviously been so many actions against salt, so it obviously has to come down to adding sugar back in, and that is where the problem lies. You know, too much sugar in the diet, particularly for people who are really insulin resistant, is just a recipe for disaster. So, I think I lost you a little bit, Sam.
So yeah, we just need to be. Yeah, I went off there for a second. My computer just went on a freeze for a little bit. But it's all good. It's all good. But yeah, it is. It's a real problem. And we do actually have a question in the comments section about that. And let me bring it up just now. It's from Phil Thompson. who asked, does obesity lead to type 2 diabetes, or does type 2 diabetes lead to obesity, or something like insulin resistance leads to both? And what is kind of the timeline of this, and what's going on?
Yeah, okay, that's quite a... Okay, let's look at it a little second. So basically, if you are obese and overweight, basically it is the overweight and the obesity that then causes hyperinsulinemia. And basically, hyperinsulinemia is a precursor to pre-diabetes, and obviously pre-diabetes is a precursor to the development of type 2 diabetes. The way that hyperinsulinemia comes about, so obviously the bigger that you get, obviously the more adipose tissue that you have. And what that then causes is it causes the body's insulin, which is obviously the hormone which probably most people will know that obviously helps to absorb glucose into the body. What that actually ends up doing, what the body starts doing, is it, the target muscles basically aren't able to use this insulin anymore. So you start to get higher levels of insulin in the body, basically. So it's this hyperinsulinemia that starts from there. And then as you continue to either obviously stay that way or gain more weight, is predominantly what a lot of people occurs with them, your pancreas then obviously needs to keep working harder because it's pumping out more insulin, but it can't get into the body, it can't get into these target cells. And that's like if you imagine a machine where it's just, you know, it's, you're chucking all this stuff in, but there's a blockage somewhere and it can't get out. Eventually, something has to give. And what starts happening is the beta cells within the pancreas, which is what produces the insulin, start to slowly shut down. And this is where we start to get the look of pre-diabetes. Now, actually, if you can get someone at the pre-diabetic stage, you could actually stop them from progressing on to that sort of type 2 diabetes level. But unfortunately, if you look at the way sort of diabetes is diagnosed, etc., in the UK, pre-diabetes isn't on what's known as the GP's quaff point system. So GPs will get points for obviously diagnosing, treating, etc., conditions. They get points and money for treating, diagnosing type 2 diabetes, but they don't get this for pre-diabetes. And this is where sort of a lot of the problem can lie with it. So, sort of long answer short, basically it is the obesity that will start with the hyperinsulinemia, and then from there it will lead on to pre-diabetes and there from type 2 diabetes. Timeline, I'm not 100% sure if I could give a timeline. It really, really would depend on the individual, how sensitive you are to insulin, etc. as well. I mean, obviously the classic kind of case, if you are sort of a naturally a person that accumulates fat and adipose tissue around your middle, sort of the more apple shape, that is obviously someone who's, you can look at them and sort of say you're going to be a lot more insulin resistant than someone obviously that carries weight and stores it in other places. But yeah, it basically is overweight and obesity will, and technically is what is driving type 2 diabetes. Right. And there was something that just came out today, I think it was something like there's now over 700 people that are being diagnosed with type 2 diabetes in the UK. And I think out of all the diabetics in the UK, 90% of them are type 2. You know, and type 2 used to be called actually adult onset diabetes, but now there's so many children developing it that they generally had to change the names of them as well. So it's a disease, I think by the year sort of 2030 as well, I think they predict that if we don't get diabetes under control now, diabetes alone is going to cripple the NHS. Nothing to do with any other comorbidities that obesity alone could bring, never mind everything else that other people can suffer from. Mm-hmm. But type 2 diabetes could cripple the NHS, which, you know, is startling figures within there.
Absolutely, and it's a bit of a disaster, really, and especially seeming that even some of the big sort of diabetes charities are kind of possibly giving the wrong advice. So, yeah. What's actually causing the type 2 diabetes, and what is kind of the solution, the best solution that we've kind of got at the moment?
Mm-hmm. Well, the diabetes. Obviously, it's been caused by being overweight and obese, so obviously we know that within there. What's really ramming that up, in my personal opinion, is what I believe it to be, is the Eat Well plate, or the standard sort of dietary guidelines that we have, I believe are out of kilt. And particularly, I believe that the carbohydrate or the starchy carbohydrate level is just far too high for us as a population. When you look at what obesity is. I mean, the problem is with obesity is it's not one, it's not as simple, again, just like saying it's not eat less, do a little bit more. Mm-hmm. The etiology of obesity is made up of lots of different factors, and that includes not only your own biology and physiology and your genetics. I know a lot of people kind of shy away from the genetic part because people think, oh, it's just all in my genes. Actually, a lot of it is, but mm-hmm. it's your biology, your physiology, the environment that you live in, and your psychology as well. So all these factors play up a huge, huge part with that. And when it comes to the foods that you eat, the way that we eat now, and particularly this reliance on or this thinking that we need these carbohydrates, is, to me, I just don't think is right. I don't think we need that level. I particularly don't think it should be based on sort of all these starchy carbohydrates. Granted, the question of the fruits and vegetables, I do think we, you know, for a lot of people, again, it would depend on the sources. So if you already have type 2 diabetes, then your diet obviously will look very different to someone who's not. But I think in general, if we're looking at it as sort of like a public health, you know, across the population level, mm-hmm. I think our this eat well plate, if you like, or pyramid, or however it's known across the world, is out of whack. And I don't think that is the best way that we should be following things. And I think that sugar and fat should never have been lumped together the way that it's been. Mm-hmm. And sugar shouldn't even play a role within the eat well plate. You know, we talk about this eat balanced diet, etc., eat everything in moderation, but we're Again, there's some one thing that I often kick myself from coming back to university, and I keep bringing it back to that, but we never ever asked to see the evidence of where the eat well plate came from. And people say that there is evidence, but I've never ever seen it. I've never ever seen anybody, you know, relate to it. And if anybody can give me the references of where that was devised from, you know, I'd love to look over that. I've never seen it, so I don't know where it comes from. I think, though, once, and I'll come back to your other question of what to do, I think, obviously, once you are diagnosed as diabetic, I mean, the problem with diabetes, and this is what I specialise my master's research in, is the problem with diabetes is once you are diagnosed as type 2 diabetic, then unless you fix your diet and your lifestyle, it's going to get progressively worse. You might just start off on lifestyle modification, but you'll eventually be put on tablets of some form, and 9 times out of 10 you will eventually have to progress insulin injections. And if you still aren't getting under control, obviously lots of other what are called as micro and macrovascular complications, which could be things like nephropathy, obviously neuropathy, and cardiovascular disease can obviously come into play there. So for me, and what I've worked with and what my master's research was on, was looking at putting people with diabetes onto a lower carbohydrate diet. Now, again, there's obviously a lot of controversy around there, etc., but there is actually a lot of evidence. If you just look at low carbohydrate and the evidence that's within there within diabetes, there is a huge amount of evidence within there. I wrote a 12,000-word thesis on low carbohydrate diets and diabetes, so there is most definitely evidence out there, I can assure you. And even from the work that I did, people that I've worked with, for me, just taking aside everything else to do with low carbohydrate and all the other arguments, for me, I just can't understand why you would recommend someone with diabetes who has a problem within themselves, so they're not functioning as a normal person, you would recommend them to eat well plate. For me, I can't get my head around that. And I think, again, it might not be that every diabetic follows the same low-carb diet, etc., and you know, you can argue ketogenic, non-ketogenic, that's a whole other sort of matter within there. Quite frankly, I've worked diabetics ranging from ketogenic to just low-carb, but you should never ever follow this high-starch carbohydrate diet and just match it with insulin. And again, I've had some dietitians saying to me they would rather someone can enjoy foods like chocolate and, you know, really high sugary foods and just match it with insulin as long as they can enjoy the foods. But what they don't realize is that insulin in itself, so this is kind of what my research looked at, is because diabetics already find it difficult to lose weight. There's a physiological mechanism that goes on that makes it difficult for individuals with diabetes to lose weight. And if you then make them take more insulin itself can cause you to gain weight. And that's why quite often people sort of inject with insulin, the sort of fatty deposits under the skin, etc., can build up. So recommending them something to eat, something in their diet their body physiologically can't process anymore, just bemuses me. But that's one of my probably my biggest bugbears when it comes to that. So
absolutely, it's very fair as well, Emily, because that just to me that seems like a massive cognitive dissonance right mm-hmm. there. That you know you're telling someone yeah eat the foods that you want, but you can inject the hormone that's kind of made you fat in the first place, and that's fine, you know, which is going to be a vicious cycle of them becoming larger and larger and storing more energy as body fat, and then their type 2 diabetes is going to get worse and worse and worse, and probably lead on to other things as well, because type 2 diabetics are at higher risk of things like cancer, Alzheimer's, and things like that. So kind of, did any of your research kind of look into those pathways and how that sort of leads onto it?
It didn't extensively, because I didn't have too long with the research.
Yeah, that's another master's degree and
PhD. It's a PhD within there, yeah. I thought I'd give myself a little bit of a break after 5 years. One thing I did look at was obviously I took a group of low carbohydrate just obese individuals, and I compared them to low carbohydrate obese individuals with type 2 diabetes. And what I wanted to do was look at the rate of weight loss between the two groups. And what I found was that those that were just obese but non-diabetic lost more weight than those that were diabetic, mm-hmm. which kind of was what I expect within there. And then what I did was I took, so the diabetic group who were on the low carb diet, I kind of took it one step further and sort of looked into the research of diabetics that have been put on the conventional sort of weight loss programs, so low fat, low calorie, etc. Compared the rate of weight loss between what you can get on low carb and low fat. So although they still didn't lose as much weight as, you know, their non-diabetic counterparts, the weight that they lost on low carb was much more significant than when they followed something like low fat or low calorie counting program. And the benefits that, so then I took it again one step further from there, and I looked at medications. Obviously I looked at all their diabetes markers, HbA1c, fasting blood glucose, etc. And then it was 10 participants I had in each group, so obviously not a huge study either, but out of the 10 that I had, 9 of them were on some form of medication, 1 was newly diagnosed, so obviously wasn't on medication as of yet, and all 9 of them, the either drastically reduced their medication or came off it altogether. So that in itself for me, aside from, you know, everything else within there, it was the improvements in the diabetic markers, their HbA1c, and this is where a lot of people say, because you know they say low carb can reverse diabetes, etc. I have a bit of a hard time with that kind of wording, because mm-hmm. technically once you've got type 2 diabetes, your pancreas, you know, your cells are pretty much destroyed. So unless you get a cell transplant, you're never going to get those cells back. So to say it's reversing, I think, is a little bit misleading, because you've still got that problem. I think you can say that you are physiologically, when you look at your biomarkers, you're that of a normal person, because you're hitting obviously your HbA1c and fasting and blood glucose, as I said. If you then revert back to the way that you were eating before and add in all those carbohydrates, etc., then by all means your diabetes will start manifesting again. So that's the only thing, and as I say, I've seen, and again it's probably the way media and etc. get hold of a lot of these papers, and that's why you should never just read a media headline and always try and get hold of the study. Because there's lots of other factors that happen in there. Mm-hmm. But coming back to your original question, I didn't look specifically at the mechanisms, etc. I did do a lot of sort of the pre-reading and spoke about it in my discussion and that kind of thing. So a lot of it comes back to do with the insulin and the way that the body is processing certain hormones as to why diabetics find it difficult to lose weight.
Absolutely, and that's kind of that's the underpinning thing that's kind of connecting all of these chronic diseases today, is excessive kind of secretion of insulin and also insulin resistance, isn't it?
Yeah. So there is a lot more coming out about that, and I think because, as I said, because overweight and obesity drives this hyperinsulinemia aspect, and because we're just filled with, you know, we're surrounded the way that obviously our environment is, you know, you can't get away from the aspect of carbohydrates, and your body never is really allowed to have that rest from it. And the thing that gets me is when, you know, as soon as you say to a dietitian you are the word ketosis, they obviously automatically think diabetic ketoacidosis, and I know a lot of people have spoken about this before, etc. Those two are not the same biological pathway. Never have been, never will be, never can be. And actually, we're designed to be in this, you know, we're not designed to be in this state of feast all the time, and this is where lies the problem, particularly the types of foods that we have. And your body is naturally, it's okay to go without food for sometimes. You know, we do it every night, we go to bed. You know, it's actually okay. And that's another aspect that I just sort of started getting into as well, is a little bit more with intermittent fasting, which again is a whole other thing within there. You know, and I think there's all these different tools, and my major thing is, and again coming back to the story of not to be too aggressive or argumentative with dietitians, etc. But it's just about to say that there is more than one option. And I always remember when we first started our master's degree, that the sort of two main caveats were first of all, wanted us to be able to leave there to critically think. If we got nothing else from it, you should be able to pick up a paper and, you know, not pick holes in it, but unfortunately not every study out there is never going to be the best study ever, just the way that obviously it works. And the second thing was, and it was Professor Broom, and he ruffled a few feathers, which he sometimes can be known to do. But he basically, so in my master's, there was a lot of other dietitians, etc., on the course. And he basically said that if they sometimes just stood outside the box a little bit and stopped just saying and putting someone on a 500-calorie deficit, we perhaps wouldn't be in this problem. And that's the thing, is it's just trying to say that, you know, there, and again, I sometimes hate saying this, there isn't this one approach for all, because I think even sometimes with, you know, low carb, as I say, you come to that thing of ketogenic versus non-ketogenic, and maybe not everybody's going to get on with ketogenic, you know, and that's not to say that it's the body, but again, it could be the environment, there, you know, there's social aspect, there's so many other factors that you can't say for certain. But it's about giving them the tools. It's about going to your GP, and instead of you going every single time and thinking, again, it comes back to psychology. You know, someone who's overweight or obese, so much psychological factors going on within there. And they've actually done a lot of qualitative work on GPs and found out what their opinions are, obviously, against sort of obese people. And some of the stuff that come out of there is quite shocking. And GPs are actually, they're quite scared to broach the subject with some people. They don't know how to talk about losing weight. They don't know how to get into that conversation, because sometimes they just think it's a gluttony thing more than anything else.
Yeah.
And, you know, and they just think they're lying and they've not done it properly. They're not working hard enough. And that's not always the case. It's because what they're being prescribed isn't right for their body type. But the GP as well, again, are they really to blame, because they're not trained in nutrition? I mean, they get something like 2 weeks out of the whole of their medical career on nutrition. So it's just about being able to have those tools and being able to think, okay, this person, you know, is a little bit more insulin resistant, so actually maybe telling them just to cut 500 calories isn't going to work. They've tried it, let's try something else, you know, and it's about having that open conversation and about having evidence base. I mean, don't get me wrong, I am definitely one for evidence base. I come from a very strong science background. But the thing is, there is evidence there, and it's just about making it accessible and having people read this evidence. And again, it's, you know, it's putting it all out there. So for me, that's kind of the way I think it should go with it. I think I've totally got off on another caveat there.
Emily. It's great. It's good, because sometimes tangents sort of lead to enlightened moments, you know. So don't worry about it. Absolutely. So sort of yourself, you're a healthy young woman, obviously you must eat very well. So what does your daily diet look like, and would your daily diet kind of be the general recommendations for the population at large?
No, definitely not. I am that person, so when I go with my friends, I'm the weird one that asks for the really weird things or the substitutions on their food. I generally personally follow a diet that's based on low carbohydrate principles. I've done ketogenic before, and probably when I first sort of started getting into low carb, I did ketogenic. I don't necessarily follow ketogenic now, and that's not because it didn't work for me or whatever. It's just, you know, sometimes just doesn't fit in that way. Some days I might fall more ketogenic than others, just purely from what I've chosen to eat. But my sort of general day, probably some mornings I get up And as I say, I've been experimenting a little bit with intermittent fasting. So I might not eat until about 12, 12-ish. And then I'll have, generally it's always eggs of some kind. Sometimes I'm in a rush, I'll just actually have some eggs mashed up with some butter. a little bit of paprika in there if I'm in a rush. Other times an omelette with some salmon and some avocado. I do try and sort of get some greens in there if possible. I'm a huge fan of veg. I eat all types of veg. I don't really restrict myself on that anymore. Fruit, predominantly we'll have sort of berries, stone fruit like nectarines and plums just now because obviously a little bit more in season. I do sometimes even have bananas as well, so if I'm training quite a lot, I'll often just make a banana pancake. So again, I'll try and balance it out with a little bit of protein. Also maybe wouldn't have that first thing in the morning either. And then dinner is just, again, I always find it strange, and the dinner is just basically anything just without the carbs. So whatever that is, and whoever either my family or friends are having, I'll have exactly the same, just don't give me the pasta, bread, rice, or potatoes. Mm-hmm. I do sometimes eat a little bit of sweet potato. I go through certain phases of different foods I like. So generally, overall, my diet is quite low in carbohydrates. Don't get me wrong, there probably is times I probably have, you know, times you're on holiday or whatever, and I will eat things that probably I wouldn't normally, but I do pay the consequences. My digestion, I probably look about 9 months pregnant if I eat bread, so that's quite bad for myself, so I know to avoid that pretty much at all costs. But yeah, I'm low carb, and that's, as I say, if I go out to restaurants, I'll do things like get a burger, just remove the bun, take the chips off, if you have sweet potato, I'll have sweet potato, if not, I'll just get salad. I eat red meats, I eat oily fish, I eat butter. I've just been starting to get into a little bit more of Dave Asprey's Bulletproof coffee.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of playing around with that a little bit. Absolutely. I like to experiment. I like to kind of experiment on myself. And I wouldn't tell someone to do something that I perhaps hadn't done myself or tried myself. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I suppose I've probably been eating this way now for about, you know, 4 or 5 years maybe. So that's pretty much it.
Seem to be doing very well for sure. Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for your time today, Emily. Where can people get in contact with you?
And do you have any blog
coming up as well?
I maybe do. There's probably some stuff later on, till end of the year, beginning of next, that is going to be coming up, but I just can't say too much just now. I'm probably going to be making some big changes. So, but they at the minute can still find me on my blog, which is just lowcarbgenesis.co.uk or .com, and that's the same Twitter handle and same on Facebook as well. So they can find me all there. I'm quite active on Twitter, so.
Absolutely. Ideal. I recommend everybody going to check out lowcarbgenesis.com, and you can go to all the social media networks from there. And then, yeah, there's only one more thing to do, Emily, and that's to hear a smash it out from Emily Maguire. So on three, I want you to shout, smash it out. So one, two, three.
Smash it out.
Hey, there we go. Awesome. I think that's our first Scottish accent saying smash it out. So that's fantastic.
First time for everything.
Absolutely, Emily. Thank you so much for your time today, and I'll see you soon.
Thank you for having me, Sam.
Cheers. Bye.